Lupin Pharmaceuticals in association with Higher Secondary Principals Forum.
Good day, students. Myself, Mrs. Shraddha Makrand Bandekar, teacher in English at Mushtifund Higher Secondary School. So today we will be studying the last chapter from the supplementary reader Vistas, which is called Memories of Childhood. Now the theme of the lesson revolves around two autobiographical accounts dealing with women of marginalized communities. Now there are many commonalities that you will see in both these episodes by the two writers. Both narrate prejudices and humiliation faced from mainstream culture. Both are brave who use their talent and education to stand up on their own and also for their community rights. And lastly, both the characters or both the narrators of the stories use the power of pen to fight oppression. Let me just tell you a little about the story. So the story Memories of Childhood depicts the fact that children are extremely sensitive to their surroundings and they react very strongly. Both the descriptions are about the strong protest against discrimination and indignities. I think, students, it would not be wrong to say that our memories, especially childhood, which happens to be the most important phase of our lives, actually makes us a better person or a bad person in the long run. So if you have a very happy and a joyful childhood, if you have beautiful memories of your childhood, you will certainly rise up to be someone really great in the long run. The first writer of the first episode in this story, Zitkala Shah, represents the Native American women condemning the dogma and evil of oppression. On the other hand, Bama criticizes the evil of untouchability and caste discrimination. Let us look at the writer of the first episode, Zitkala Shah. Zitkala Shah, also known as Gertrude Simmons Bonin, her missionary given and later married name was Yankton Dakota. Writer, editor, translator, musician, educator, and a political activist. She wrote several works chronicling her struggles with cultural identity and the pull between the majority culture she was educated within and her Dakota culture into which she was born and raised. Her later books were among the first works to bring traditional Native American stories to a widespread white English speaking readership, and she has been noted as one of the most influential Native American activists of the 20th century. Now children, to tell you in simpler words, Zitkala Shah, you must have already heard that she was a writer, editor, translator, musician, educator, a political activist, but she has had a troubled childhood. And we will see what exactly happens with her. So the episode that we will be dealing with first is called The Cutting of My Long Hair. Gertrude Simmons, who is the narrator of the story, so these are the main characters in the story. Judwin is her friend, and there's a pale-faced woman who could either be a teacher or a member of the staff at the Carlisle Indian Industrial School in Carlisle. Now let me just brief you a little about the Carlisle Indian Industrial School. Now this was that time when the American population was not great, it was not too much, and the people thought that in order to increase their population, they will have to convert, they will have to transform the Native Americans, that is to say the Red Indians, into people who are much more polished. So the Carlisle Indian Industrial School was one such place where you could get finished products, in the sense that you can just look at the pictures here. Children, the picture to your left tells you how a person has been transformed. You can see the first picture is his picture when he was actually a Red Indian, a Native American, and later you can see his transformation after being at the Carlisle Indian School. So the story begins with Zitkala's first day in a boarding school, Carlisle Indian School. It is a school opened for Native Indians where they are trained to leave behind their own culture and become a part of the American culture. Now children, you know, this might sound very, very mundane to you. You know, many a times we tend to follow a different culture and we do it because we have no choice. But here, can you imagine what Zitkala Shah or the other Native Americans must have undergone? That is because they were forced to live a different life altogether. They were forced to give up on their traditions, on their culture, on their beliefs. And let us see what happens. So Zitkala Shah's first day at the boarding school, that is the Carlisle Indian School, wherein all the people were forced to leave behind their culture and become a part of the American culture. Now children, you can see here, the pictures here tell you very well. You know, the first picture to my left, wherein you again have the first picture is divided into two pictures. You can see the first one, there's this girl who is really sitting in a very, very dejected manner on the floor. And mind you, it is the same girl who has been transformed after being at the Carlisle Indian Industrial School for a long time. So Zitkala Shah describes that she really felt bad when a shawl was taken off her shoulders by the school authorities before entering into the dining hall. So if you can pay attention to the picture again, the girl there who is sitting dejectedly on the floor is wearing a shawl around her shoulders. So the moment Zitkala Shah entered the school authorities snatched her shawl. She also wonders how other Indian girls agreed to wear tight clothes which were immodest according to her, as their whole body shape could be easily seen. Now dressing is something which is, or you know, dressing style is something which has passed on from generations to us. So when it comes to the Native Indians, they had a particular style of dressing. You can see another picture there. There's a girl standing there who has long hair. And if you pay attention to her attire is pretty loose. But when you look at the other picture wherein this girl is sitting there on a chair, you can see that she is wearing clothes that are quite tight. And according to Zitkala Shah, it was very, very immodest on the part of so many other Indian girls who had surrendered to following or adapting to this new culture. When she came to this school, she found it a strange place where everything seemed to be mechanical. A very loud and metallic bell rang for breakfast. There was an annoying clatter of feet on the entire bare floor. She is unnerved because of so much noise. Here, she finds that all the girls start marching to the dining room after hearing the bell. So children, here's a picture of the dining room at the Carlisle Indian School. And you can see very well that, you know, it is accommodating quite a number of children there. Now, what Zitkala Shah does not like at the Carlisle Indian School is that everything out there is very, very mechanical. Mechanical in the sense, you know, although you could call it discipline, since they are children, they should be given enough freedom to explore themselves and also the surroundings. But here everything was so mechanical. There was a loud metallic bell which rang, and the moment the bell rang, it meant you were supposed to go in to the dining room for your breakfast. She says that, you know, she was really annoyed with the clatter of the feet. So the children, the Native Indians, would wear soft moccasins. Moccasins are soft and flat shoes. But according to the new culture at the Carlisle Indian School, they were asked to wear heels. So again, there was a shift, there was a change from the cultural background to adapting a new culture altogether now. So, Zitkala sir begins to notice each and every change that she is forced to undergo. Let us just review them quickly, children. The first change is that she is asked to remove her shawl, rather her shawl is snatched. The second is that there is a bell and she is expected to work according to the bell. She also notices that the children there were immodestly dressed. She also finds that they were all wearing heels. Let us see what happens next. They were supervised by a pale-faced woman. Small girls wore aprons and shingled hair. The girls were dressed in clinging clothes. There was a bell to stand, another to sit, next to pray, and after that another to start the breakfast. The breakfast was served and eaten very mechanically. She did not like the eating by formula method. So, you know, children, the moment she gets into the Carlisle Indian School, she realizes that whatever is happening there is not something that she would like. She finds that she is being watched, you know, she is being looked over by a pale-faced woman who could either be their teacher, she could be some other staff at the Carlisle Indian School, or she could be the warden. And she also finds that, all the Indian girls or the native Indian girls were asked to wear aprons and their hair was shingled. Now, shingled hair means your hair is cut, you know, maybe just this much. So, all the girls had their hair cut and the older girls were asked to wear clinging clothes. Now, let me just explain to you the eating by formula method. Now, like I told you in the previous slide, you know, there was a bell. The moment the bell was given, everyone rushed to the dining hall. Now, there was another bell, and when this other bell rang, everybody was supposed to stand in their places. But the moment the bell rang, poor Zitkala sa just pulled a chair and she sat down. When she realized that every other person is standing, at the second bell, she stood up, but all the others sat down. So, you know, there was a lot of mismatch that was happening here because Zitkala sa was not aware of the rules and regulations of the Carlisle Indian School. Now, children, if you happen to go to a new school or a new place, but if you are not informed about the rules and regulations of that school, of course, there is going to be a lot of haphazardness that is going to happen. But if you are briefed on what you are supposed to do, how you are supposed to behave, what are some of the compulsory rules of that particular institute or that college or that workplace, you will realize that you are in a better place to put yourself. But here we find that Zitkala sa was not given any prior instructions so as to what are the rules of the Carlisle Indian School, and she was forced to act accordingly as though she has already inherited all the rules, you know, when she was a child. So when the third bell goes and she is supposed to pray, she just begins to cry because she doesn't understand what is to be done. And at the next bell, when she's actually supposed to have breakfast, she's still, she's still nervous and she doesn't know how to go about it. So Zitkala sa finds it very annoying, the eating by formula method, because she feels that there is a lot of interference that is happening from the authorities at the Carlisle Indian School, wherein they are not allowing people like Zitkala sa to be themselves. Let's continue, children. All this was totally new to the narrator. Her friend Judwin warned her that the pale-faced woman was talking about the cutting of her long hair. The narrator did not want her hair to be shingled because in her community, shingling of hair was considered as inauspicious and undignified. Only the traitors or mourners had their hair shingled. Now, children, you know, here's another picture which is going to tell you about how transformations at Carlisle Indian School happen. You can see the picture to the left, okay, the first picture wherein you will find that everyone there is looking a little shabby. That is the native Indian look that people had, wherein their hair was really long, okay, and if you can pay attention, they are not wearing clothes that are very tight fitting. On the other hand, you can see that the family, the entire family of brothers and sisters has undergone a transformation, and you can see that the boys there have short hair. You can see a small girl there, you know, who is resting on her older sibling's lap, and you can see even her hair has been shingled. So now it was time for Zitkala Shah to get her hair cut, to get her hair shingled. And her friend Judwin, who was there at the institute for quite some time, told her that there was a pale faced woman, you know, the same woman who I told you could be either their teacher or the warden. She had been speaking about cutting the long hair of the narrator. Now this really put off the narrator, because she was not willing to cut her hair, she was not willing to get her hair shingled, because she was born and brought up in such an environment wherein she was told that cutting of the long hair is extremely inauspicious and very undignified. So she was not willing to do something which is not accepted by her family. Also, there were traitors, or they were mourners who had a label on them, and the symbol for people to identify traitors or mourners was that their hair was shingled. So can you imagine, children, the amount of trauma, the amount of mental torture Zitkala Shah must have undergone the moment she realized that her hair is soon going to be cut. Let us see what happens next. Though her friend told her that they would have to submit as others were stronger, the narrator decided to struggle and not to submit. She creeps upstairs unnoticed and hid under the bed in a dark corner. But finally, she was discovered and dragged out. She scratched and kicked, but was forcibly taken downstairs and tied fast to a chair, and her long hair was cut off. This cruelty crushed her spirit. She remembered the comfort of her home. Now children, there are times when you know that your opposite is a stronger counterpart. You know, let's take for example, there is a game and there are two teams that are playing. If the other team is very strong, okay, if you have that fighting spirit, you will still say that I am going to try myself, I am going to try my luck, and maybe I will win. But can you imagine the scenario out here? Zitkala Shah comes from a minority, she comes from a marginalized community. There are many others who are much more powerful than her. So even if she is not willing to get her hair cut, she knows that she will have to surrender. But she is not willing to surrender all that easily. So what does she do? When her friend tells her that, you know, they are going to come to cut her hair, she runs upstairs and she tries to hide in a dark corner under the bed. But the authorities find her and they literally drag her, okay, like how you would drag a prey. They drag her in that manner. They bring her downstairs, they tie her to a chair so that she can't move and she can't react to all that is happening. And ultimately, you can see the picture there, her long hair, you know, her braid is cut off. Now the moment her braid is cut off, she is totally crushed by spirit. Now I would just like to elaborate a little here. You know, children, there are two kinds of deaths that exist. The first one is when your body stops functioning. Okay, that's a biological death, as you would call it. The other death is the death of your spirit. You know, you were so hurt, you were so battered that your spirit has already gone. You know, it's already dead. And there is no way by which you can revive it back. Now, poor Zitkalasa also had her spirit crushed with this act of, this act of cutting her long hair. And she really felt very, very uncomfortable in this place now. She felt like she was being choked. And she remembers the comfort of her home. So children, let us quickly review what happens in the episode, the cutting of my long hair. So Zitkalasa initially goes to the Carlisle Indian school. When she goes there, you know, her shawl is taken away from her. And she realizes, she finds that there are many other Indian girls who are immodestly dressed, you know, wearing skin fitting clothes or tight clothes. Next, there is a bell that is rung and she is taken to the dining hall. There is a particular fashion, there is a particular method, a mechanized method of eating the food. And Zitkalasa is not told about how this manner works. So, you know, there is a mismatch of the bells, you know, when one bell is given, when she is supposed to do something, she doesn't do it and she feels humiliated all by herself. Next, she comes across many more native Indians and she finds that they have all surrendered, they have all forgotten their culture and they have adapted to this new culture, which is the American culture. She also realizes that, you know, their dressing sense has changed to a great extent. The girls are wearing aprons and the older girls are wearing tight fitting clothes. When she is still trying to get used to this new atmosphere, which is still uncomfortable for her, there is another bad news that comes to her, and this is told to her by her friend Judwin. She tells her that our hair is going to be cut. Zitkalasa is not okay with this act of cutting of her long hair because it is going to label her as a traitor or a mourner in her community. So, you know, she tries her level best to hide herself, but poor Zitkalasa is not at all powerful. And so she is forced to surrender and her beautiful long hair is cut. I hope there is no problem, children. Let's move on to the next episode. So the next episode is written by the author Bama. Bama, also known as Bama Faustina Susairaj, is a Tamil Dalit feminist, committed teacher and a novelist. She rose to fame with her autobiographical novel, Karku, which chronicles the joys and sorrows experienced by Dalit Christian women in Tamil Nadu. Bama was born in 1958 as Faustina Mary Fatima Rani in a Roman Catholic family belonging to Pariyar community from Puttupati in the then Madras state. Later, she accepted Bama as her pen name. Her father, Susairaj, was employed in the Indian Army and her mother was Sebastiamma. She is the sister of the famous Dalit writer Raj Gautaman. Bama's grandfather had converted from Hinduism to Christianity. So children, this particular writer, you know, she was a Dalit. Now, a Dalit is a community which was considered to be untouchables back then. So, she tries to tell us about the sorrows and the joys that she has experienced as a Dalit Christian woman in Tamil Nadu. And, you will see in the introduction that although her father was employed in the Indian Army, yet she did not get that respect that she actually deserved. And she was ridiculed, she was humiliated. And let us see what she has to tell us in her episode, We Too Are Human beings. So in the story, we too are human beings. The main characters are as follows. You have Bama, who happens to be the narrator of the story. There is an old man of her community. He is an elderly man, a very well respected man. There is a landlord who is an upper class master, and there is Annan, Bama's brother, who we have just learned turns out to be a great Dalit writer in the long run. So she was walking home from school one day. It was possible to walk the distance in 10 minutes, but it would usually take her at least 30 minutes. She watched all the fun and games, novelties and oddities in the streets, the shops and the bazaar. Each thing would pull her to a standstill and not allow her to go any further. Now, you know, children, this is something which is very common. If you can go back to your childhood, you will know that your parents would walk fast, but you were the one who would be left behind because you would love to see all that you can along the road. So Bama also could usually complete the distance. She could cover up the distance in just 10 minutes, but it would take her nothing less than 30 minutes because she would be engrossed in watching all the things in the streets. Speeches by leaders of political parties, street plays, puppet show, stunt performances, or some other entertainment happened from time to time. Now, you know, children, the street is such a beautiful place. It is such a wonderful place because, you know, you can come across, you can see people of different types. You can see how they communicate. You can see what they sell. For you and me, something might be trash, but they are going to, you know, they are going to tell you so much about that little thing that they even have the capacity to convince you to buy that item of theirs. So all these little things, you know, there were speeches by leaders of political parties, there were street plays, there were puppet shows, there were performances. Also, she watched waiters pouring coffee from one tumbler to the other to cool it. Now, you know, Tamil Nadu or the South India is a place where their favorite beverage happens to be coffee. And if you have seen in movies or in stills, there is a particular way how they cool the coffee. They transfer the coffee from one tumbler to the other, and you know, it is really fascinating to see how they don't throw a single drop of the coffee on the floor. So she would be really amazed to see all these things. There were people chopping up onions with their eyes turned to the other side. There were almonds blown from the tree by the wind. So there was so much of activity that was happening in the streets. According to the season, there would be various fruits. So there were vendors who would sell various fruits, and she saw people selling sweets and tasty snacks like payasam, halwa, iced lollies. So children, can you just imagine what a bustle the street must have been, that every little thing caught the attention of little Bama. One day she saw in her street a threshing floor set up in the corner. Their people were driving cattle in pairs round and round to crush the grain from straw. The animals were muzzled. She saw the landlord seated on a piece of sacking spread over a stone slab. He was watching the proceedings. She stood there for a while watching the fun. Now children, you know, just as she was moving about, as she was approaching her house, she saw that there was a threshing floor which was set up. Now, you know, there is a method by which you separate the grain from the husk, which is called as threshing. So it was a threshing floor which had been set up, and there were people who were driving the cattle in a circular motion. So, you know, there was maybe a stick or a rod, and the cattle were tied there, and the cattle were asked to rotate in the same direction, and the action of their feet would actually help in threshing or separating the grain from the straw. So all this was happening and the cattle were muzzled. Now a muzzle is a a muzzle is a kind of a protective cover that you put over the face of an animal. You must have seen dogs have a muzzle because sometimes the barking of the dogs becomes too annoying. And so what does the master do? The master fixes a muzzle to the mouth so that the sound of the dog, or so that the dog should not scream or bark. Now in this case, the cattle here were muzzled because the landlord did not want the cattle to eat the straws that were lying on the floor. So the Bama finds that the cattle had been muzzled. She also notices that the landlord was sitting on a piece of sack over a stone slab. So she is shocked to see that with so much of happening, the landlord is taking rest, the landlord is at peace. He was watching the proceedings. She stood there for a while watching the fun. Now, all this is very, very appealing to Bama because she has not seen such episodes before. So she is at a distance and she is watching everything and she finds it all to be fun. Just then, she saw an elder of their community coming from the direction of the bazaar. He looked quite funny in his manner. He held out a packet by its string without touching it. Then he went to the landlord, bowed low, and extended the packet towards him. He cupped the hand that held the string with the other hand. The landlord opened the parcel and began to eat vadais. Now children, Bama was at a distance. She was watching all the proceedings. She was watching all the happenings there. When she came across an elder of her community. Now an elder here refers to a respected person in her community. And she saw that he was coming from the direction of the bazaar. So he had possibly been to the bazaar and he was coming back now. And she finds him looking very, very funny. That's because he held a packet in such a manner that he was not at all touching it to himself or to his body. So he held a packet in such a manner. You can see the picture there, children. He held a packet in such a manner that he was only touching the strings of the packet. Now the moment he reached closer to the landlord, he bowed down and he gave him the packet. He cupped the hand that held the string with the other hand. So he held it in such a manner that he did not really touch the contents in the packet. The landlord opened the parcel and began to eat the vadais. So there were vadas that were brought for the landlord, and the landlord had sent this man who was supposedly an elder from Bama's community. But Bama is shocked to see that he is not getting the same respect that he actually gets in her community. Let's continue, children. So she comes home and she told her brother the story with its comic details. Anand was not amused. He told her that the elder was carrying a package for his upper caste landlord. These people believe that the lower caste should not touch them. If they did, they would be polluted. That was the reason why he had to carry the package by the string. She became sad on listening all this. She felt angry towards the people of the upper caste. Now children, what happens here is that, she comes home and she narrates the entire story to her elder brother. And her elder brother is not at all amused. On the contrary, he tells her things in a very nice manner. He tells her that, Bama, we belong to the lower community, we belong to the lower caste, and we are looked down upon in the society. He also tells her that the elder of our community is a servant to the upper class master or to the upper class landlord. He tells her that if we touch anything, it is believed that we will pollute that item, that place, or that eatable. And he tells her that that is precisely the reason why the package was carried by the string. Now, you know, there is a sudden outrage of emotion here, and Bama becomes very angry on understanding all this. She gets very upset with the people belonging to the upper caste. She thought that these miserly people who had collected money somehow had lost all human feelings. But the lower caste were also human beings. They should not do petty jobs for them. They should work in their fields, take their wages home and leave it at that. Now, you know, Bama tries to think in a very, very practical manner. She tries to feel, or you know, she is trying to convey to all of us that just because there is one particular community which has more money, they can't boss over others who belong to a lower caste or a lower community. And she also tries to make one point very clear to all of us that everyone on this earth is a human being. More than caste, creed and religion, we need to follow and appreciate humanity first. So she feels that the lower caste or the lower community should not surrender to people from the upper caste. They should not do jobs for them, and she feels that they should only do what they are supposed to do. That is, say the lower caste is supposed to work in fields. They should only do that, finish their job, take their money home and leave things to that. Anand, her brother, was studying at a university. He had come home for the holidays. He would often go to the library in their neighboring village in order to borrow books. One day, the landlord's men met him. Thinking him to be a stranger, he addressed Anand respectfully. His manner changed on knowing his name, and he asked for the street he lived. The street would indicate their caste. Now, children, you know, Anand, Bama's brother, was studying at the university, and he would come sometimes to his house, but he would love to read, and so he would go to the neighboring village to borrow books. So one day, one of the landlord's men met Bama's brother, and he begins to question him. He begins to ask him about his name, about the place where he stays. And when her brother narrates and tells him his full name and the place where he stays, he comes to know that he belongs to a particular caste, and his behavior towards him changes all of a sudden. Now, children, earlier, you know, in Goa, we still have the same system. Earlier, there were wards or there were vados, and each vado was dedicated to a particular occupation. So all the carpenters used to stay in one ward. Likewise, here also, you know, there was one street which was dedicated to a particular caste. So here, the moment Bama's brother tells the landlord's men where he stays and his surname, the landlord's men is at once aware of his caste and his race, and he, you know, his attitude towards him goes in for a change all of a sudden. Anand told her that they were not given any honor, dignity and respect because they were born in a particular community. Now, children, birth and death are things that are decided by the Almighty. Nobody knows who is going to be born in which caste, in which creed, in which race. But here, you know, our society is so rigid and it is so staunch that it has a particular thing for each community. So Anand tells her that her community was always devoid of honor, dignity and respect because they came from the caste or the community of Dalits. He advised her to study and make progress. People will come to her of their own accord then. She studied hard and stood first in her class, and many people then became her friends. So children, you know, her brother's advice to her was very simple and very, very practical. Her brother tells her that she should be studying very hard. She should be putting in a lot of effort in order to be someone in the world, in order to be someone in the society. and she does the same thing, and he tells her that if you study very well, you will find people coming to you to befriend you. And Bama does the same thing. Bama wants to rise above all these prejudices that exist, and so she decides that she is going to study very well, and she turns out to be the first in her class, and there are many children who become her friends. So children, let us quickly go to the questions and answers from the story Memories of Childhood. Both the units of Memories of Childhood present autobiographical episodes from the two lives of the two women from marginalized communities. Comment. Now children, here you will have to talk about Zitkalasa being a native Indian and Bama being a Tamil Dalit Christian. You will have to talk, you will have to discuss of what are the problems, what are the, what are the events or what are the situations that they face, and what is the kind of a feeling that they have, or how they feel about the society. The next question, why was Bama first amused at the scene of the old man carrying a food packet by its string without touching it? Why was she filled with anger, dismay and revolt later on? Now children, you need to understand here that Bama was a little girl. Okay, she was a small girl. She was not all that mature enough to understand the seriousness of the situation. So initially when she finds that the elder from her community was holding the packet in a particular manner, she finds it very, very funny and hilarious. But when her brother explains to her that they happen to come from the lower caste, they happen to come from the marginalized community, they are untouchables, they are Dalits, that is when she understands the seriousness and she becomes very furious and very angry. It may take a long time for oppression to be resisted, but the seeds of rebellion are sowed in early life. Do you agree that injustice in any form cannot escape being noticed even by children? Now, here students, you will have to talk about, different kinds of episodes that happen with children when they are really young. So, even a small slap from an elder of your family can make you feel differently about that person all your life. You might as well realize that over a period of time that person has changed. But we all need to understand that when it comes to children, the first impression is always the last one. So here also, these girls, take it Zitkalasa or Bama for that matter, they have suffered so much of oppression, and that feeling of being rebellious has already been there in them since their childhood. And that is the reason why as they grow up, they can come up as people who are strong, who can support their community, and they can be great in their own way. Bama's experience is that of a victim of the caste system. What kind of discrimination does Zitkalasa's experience depict? What are their responses to their respective situations? Now, it is already told here that Bama is a victim of the caste system. Now, with Zitkalasa, she is forced to undergo a change when it comes to her traditional and cultural values. So, if Bama is a victim of the caste system, Zitkalasa is forced to transform into a new culture, or she is asked to leave behind all her cultural and traditional beliefs and adapt and adhere to a new culture altogether. So, the responses that each one has are different because they are happening at two different levels. If you notice Bama is not really a victim of the caste system because she is not someone who has to carry that parcel by the string. She has only witnessed it because she has seen it and she has been told by her brother. But when it comes to Zitkalasa, she is someone who is forced to act. She is someone who is living in that difficult situation. And that is the reason why we find that her reaction and her response to the situation that she is facing is very, very serious. So children, with this, we come to an end of the chapter Memories of Childhood, and also we come to an end to the book Vistas, which happens to be your supplementary reader. Wishing all of you good luck. Thank you.
Prudent Scholars, powered by Lupin Pharmaceuticals.
अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस